Hello everyone, we are now going to start the last stage program of these week-long WEM 2021. And this is going to be the last session of the last stage program. And this session will be actually an invited talk that will be delivered by Professor Molloy Banerjee from IIT Kanpur. And this will be his second and final talk for this program. So I now invite Professor Molloy Banerjee to start his talk.
Thank you, Kaushik. So first, let me share my screen. Can you see my slides?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much for kind invitation. And also, this is the first time in my life that I was the inaugural speaker of this program as well as concluding speaker of this program. I hope all of you have enjoyed other talks. Some of them was in-depth mathematical. And today I'm going to talk about something on mathematical epidemiology. But as it is a some sort of weekend days, so relax, there should not be detailed or in-depth mathematics. Rather, I can try my level as to keep you engaged for 1 hour, 15 minutes through some storytelling kind of matter which are related with the mathematical epidemiology. So in my talk, I'll cover these topics a little bit of SIR model, then SIR type model, then SARS epidemic model and epidemic models with demography, just to give you some idea that how ordinary differential equation models can be used in case of epidemic growth. And then towards the end, I'll come to talk about mathematical modeling of COVID-19, what we have done so far. Not all the models, rather some of them I'll discuss. And finally, I'll mention that why we are afraid of working with the data from India, because last 1.5 year, I have given several talks at different meetings through webinar mode, and most of the time one common question was that why you have not worked on COVID data from India. So that's all I thought. Towards the end, I can say a few points that what is the difficulty for working with the data from India, and then of course at the end I'll mention some of the references. So for SIR model, this is the simplest ordinary differential equation model for epidemic growth. And this Tarmac-McKendrick SIR model, it is of very early stage mathematical model for epidemic. And keep in mind that this model, the model which is called Tarmac-McKendrick SIR model, that is valid for just one season epidemic or single outbreak epidemic. So in this case, this is a very simple model in the sense it consists with only three compartments. That is, population at any place can be divided into three groups. One group is called susceptible, one group is called infected, and other group is called recovered. And the point is that what happens that in general, before the commencement of the disease spread, each and every one are assumed to be susceptible. So nowadays, this epidemic theory have emerged a lot, and they traveled a long history for last more than 80 to 90 years, if we consider advanced level of research in epidemiology. But if we want to think about the earlier development about mathematical modeling of epidemiology, then it dates back to 300 or more years, but I am not going into that history. Rather, what I can say, this is a very simplest model. It is a starting point. And with this simple model, we can explain several important aspects of epidemiology. And also, I will show you some of my thoughts, which we have applied in order to develop and analyze the mathematical model for COVID epidemic. So the first of all, the first governing equation is dsdt equal to minus beta si. It actually explains that when ACE interacts with any infected individual, so through interaction between two individuals of human population, in this case we are considering transmissible disease within human only. So through that interaction, the susceptible individual becomes infected, and the rate at which they got the infection, that is actually denoted by beta. And due to this kind of interaction, one susceptible becomes infected, it leaves the class, and there is no other kind of phenomena responsible for change in the rate of growth of susceptible population. So that's why we can say this is a very simplest model. And once the susceptible individuals are infected, they leave the susceptible compartment and they join infected compartment. Again, keep in mind here, the assumption is that the amount of individuals which are leaving the susceptible compartment, each and every one coming to the infected compartment, there is no loss while they travel from this compartment to this compartment. Rather, you can consider it as an instantaneous change. And also there is a rate that is alpha. It is sometimes called clearance rate, sometimes it can be called recovery rate, and it measured as the inverse of the time period for which one individual remains infected. And this is the rate at which infected individuals, they are leaving the infected compartment and ultimately they join the recovered compartment. And from this modeling approach, what you can see, there is no disease-related death. So this is very simple assumption. In order to solve this problem, if we wanted to talk about this model in terms of differential equation, existence, uniqueness, etc. So for that, for the mathematical completeness of the description of the model, we need to mention that S0, I0 and R0, they are non-negative quantities. Now, once we have these equations, now from these equations, you can have several important understandings. What are those understandings? Number one, from this equation, you can understand that ACE and I, they are number of susceptible or density of susceptible and number or density of infected. So that means ACE and I both are positive variables. Rather, precisely, we can say non-negative variables. Beta is a positive constant. So it means at each point of time, ACE is a decreasing function. This is very much clear. Now, second point is that if you look at the equation for DIDT, then you can clearly understand one point, that if we take I common, so then we are left with beta S minus alpha. So the question is that at any point of time, whether the number of infected will grow or decay, that is completely controlled by the term that is beta times ST minus alpha. And this is most important point for the reason that if you start from a value S0 for which beta S0 minus alpha is less than 1, then you can say there is no chance of disease growth. If in case beta S0 is greater than alpha, then there is a possibility of disease growth. Now, suppose you are starting from an initial condition for which, that means S0 is chosen in such a way depending upon beta and alpha, that it is increasing, then the next question is that whether it will keep on increasing unboundedly or not. Answer is that as we are considering a finite population, so there should be a particular time point at which you can see that DIDT is equal to 0, and that particular threshold is given by ST equal to alpha by beta. I am mentioning all this point here because this idea or this assumption will be used afterwards in order to determine some other important quantities. But what is most important observation here? The observation is that if your beta ST minus alpha is greater than 0, then number of infected will grow with time. If beta ST minus alpha less than 0, then it will decline with the advancement of time. And the question is that whether it will be decaying to what value, and if once it is increasing, what will be the maximum value, etc., etc. So many different questions can be answered. But the most important part is that whatever we have assumed that there is no disease-related death rate, and then from the model quickly you can have one simple understanding that as DDT of S plus I plus R equal to zero, so it means at all point of time, at all time point, this sum is constant. So that means there is no change in the total number of population. And as this population is not changing over time, so it indicates that either disease is not that much dangerous kind of disease, which can be a matter of life-threatening situation for human beings. Also, it is not for a long-term disease, because if we consider this model as a disease for a long term, then we need to incorporate birth, death, etc., etc. And also, there is no other inflow or outflow at any other compartment. So that's why it remains constant at all time point. And similarly, what you can understand from here, that whatever the values of S0, I0 and R0 you will have at initial stage, at the final stage, this sum will be the same as STF, ITF and RTF, and that is equal to N. That constant is now labeled as N. And this TF is the time when disease is finished. So that means there is not a single infected individual. Okay. Now, whatever I have told you, those are actually summarized here. I am not going through these details. I will communicate this slide to the organizers. They can distribute to you, so you can have a look at it. And whatever I have said, that is written here in a step by step. But the most important part is that what I have mentioned, that I dot zero, whether it will be greater than zero or less than zero, that is determined by the sign of this quantity. And from here, if this is greater than zero, then we can have this quantity is either greater than one or less than one. In case this beta is zero minus alpha is greater than zero, then this ratio is greater than one. If this is less than zero, then it is less than one. And you know, this particular quantity is known as basic reproduction number. And formally, or sorry, informally, or in a very lucid manner, what we can mention, the definition of basic reproduction number, as the number of secondary cases produced by one infected individual during his period of infection. So that means that if we consider a particular time period over which one individual remained infected, by that time, how many people will got the infection from one infected individual, that is the measure of basic reproduction number. And in this case, for SIR model, this is simply this one. Now, apart from that, what other parameter or what other result we can derive? So first of all, let us denote that as t tends to infinity, S is denoted by S infinity and R is denoted by R infinity. And in literature, these are called measure for final size of the epidemic. So, and in order to find out the estimate of the final size of the epidemic, what you can do, you can divide third equation from the first equation in order to have this result dsdr is equal to this one. And what is the basic assumption for this model? Initially, there was no infected, there was no infection. So that means R0 is equal to 0, and therefore S0 plus I0 plus R0 will be equal to N. So that means size of the population you are considering. And then with the notation, that is S infinity and R infinity, as t tends to infinity, if you integrate this differential equation from t equal to 0 to infinity, then you can find this particular value. And then after having this result, you might be surprised to see the next step, that why directly I am substituting R infinity equal to n. The point is that as the model is the simplest one, what we can assume without any loss of generality, we can assume that after infection, period is over, there is not any susceptible. So each of them who were in the susceptible class, they are now recovered. But the point is that keep in mind, this is a rough estimate. This is not the actual estimate. Because what can happen in reality? It may happen a certain percentage of susceptible individual, they may not have the infection at the end of the infectious period or epidemic period when the epidemic outbreak is over. But still, for a reasonably large population, if N is very large, then this estimate matches with this result. So what is important? That in order to understand the final size of the epidemic, all these parameters, that means rate at which infection is spreading, the rate at which infected individuals are getting recovered, and what is the size of the population, those are all responsible in order to determine the final size of the epidemic. Now, you might be wondering that we are talking about epidemic model. I is not coming into the picture. Rather, in terms of susceptible at t tends to infinity, we are talking about size of the epidemic. This is only for the reason that if you subtract S0, calculate if you S0 minus S infinity, that will give you the number of individuals who got the infection. So that's why, although it is the value of susceptible at t tends to infinity, but it gives you the measure for number of infected, that means susceptible individuals who ultimately got the infection, that is determined by this S infinity term. And as I have mentioned, this is final size of the epidemic. And now the question is that how to determine maximum number of infected individuals. In order to find out the maximum number of infected individual, what you can do, you can now consider first equation and second equation. From first two equations, if you eliminate I, then you can have a differential equation of this particular format. And then if you integrate this equation with respect to time, then you will have this solution. And in order to find out this constant of integration, you can use the initial condition in order to have this constant is equal to this one, and therefore you can have solution of this differential equation as a solution of the initial value problem is given by this constant will be replaced by this one, and then substituting t tends to infinity, from here you can find another estimate of S infinity. And if you interested to compare, you can compare that for large population, whatever value you can find out by solving this transcendental equation, this solution will be pretty close to the value that we have considered earlier, that is S0 times e to the power minus beta by alpha into n. But in order to find out the final size, that is maximum number of infected, what we can consider? We can consider the maximum, the concept of maxima from the equation of I, that is di dt equal to 0. And from di dt equal to 0, you can find out st equal to alpha by beta. So that means the t is the time at which st attained the value alpha by beta. By that time, you will have the maximum number of infected. And now if you substitute this value st equal to alpha by beta in this equation by replacing this constant by this one, and then you can find the measure for maximum number of infected that is given by this one. So if you know the period of recovery, that is time required for recovery, and the rate of infection, and also the size of the initial susceptible and infected compartment, then from there you can clearly calculate what will be the maximum number of infected in that particular problem. And now, as an illustrative example, we can consider very old problem, that is the influenza data in a boarding school. This data is actually available in the British Medical Journal in 1978. And all the other details, if you are interested, you can have a look at it in the book by Maya Marcheva. So what does it say? It mentioned that on day 3, there was 25 number of infected individual. Day 4, 75 number of infected individual. So that means within one day, number of infected individual is increased by 50. And then on the fifth day, there is a huge increase. And then after some time, you can see they start decaying. So which indicates they have started recovering. So this is the total number of infected individual on a particular day, from where you can calculate what is the maximum number of infected individual. So for this case, what happened that there was in total 763 resident in the boarding school. So if we consider third day as the T0, so in that case S0 will be equal to 763. But the point is that you need to keep in mind that if you start from the initial condition ST equal to some finite quantity and there is no infected individual, that means I0 equal to 0. So from this simple equation, you cannot find any disease growth. So in order to have any disease growth, you need to consider at least the situation once there is at least one infected individual. So that's why instead of considering from the very starting day, we are considering the data from the third day. And on that day, what was the total demarcation? Total demarcation is now given by as total number of susceptible is the total number of students who were in the boarding school is 763. So this S3 without any loss of genetic can be considered as the initial point where I3 equal to 25, so S3 equal to 738. And from the observation, they have observed that average infective period is to 0.1 days. So that means this is somehow calculated from the clinical observation and from where you can get alpha equal to this particular value, that is 1 by 2.1 approximately equal to 0.476. And then if you calculate other components, then from final data and also the initial data, you can calculate beta by alpha is equal to this one. And then from where you can measure the clinically measured value of beta, that is equal to this one. But from above relation, what you can find beta by alpha is equal to this one. And this is for the reason that we are not dividing by the size of the population, or this is the beta, or from alpha what you calculate, you can find out this one. And now if you substitute this value into this equation, that is for calculation of maximum number of infected individual, so then you can find on a particular day you can have approximately 298 number of infected individual. And now if you look at the data and associated numerical simulation result of the equation, so you can see starting from the third day as 0th day here, this is black dots are actually number of infected individual on any particular day, and this blue curve is just the outcome of the simulation. And from this result you can understand, okay, they are matches very well. Now apart from that, what additional information we can try to bring out from here, that I'll tell you a couple of interesting points which will be important for our further study in this direction. So if you look at the growth of each of the compartment, so this blue curve is the susceptible compartment. You can see it started from some value, that is 738, and there was at most we have observed that around 19 individual they were able to escape from the flu, and this result clearly shows that S infinity is comes out to be close to the value 19. But there is a difference between actual case and numerical simulation result, because this model actually shows the number of infected theoretically will be equal to zero at infinite time. So that's why if we consider the simulation result up to 11th day, starting from 13th day as a 0th day here, still you can see certain number of infected individuals are there. So this is some sort of error which is committed here for consideration of continuous time model, although you have the data at different time points. So the discrete data is now matched with the solution of a continuous time model. And also from mathematical theory, this asymptotic behavior indicates that number of infected will be zero at infinite time. But in this case, we don't need to consider the value of I is equal to zero. Rather, value of I less than one will be sufficient one, because in case of population, value of I less than one means there is not a single individual. Now, apart from that, what we can see that at the end of the disease, if we look at the cumulative number of infected, then we can see that this curve is now becoming a saturated level and it behaves like asymptotic. And this particular phenomena is known as the term which we have heard in last 1.5 years, that is a flattening of the curve for COVID epidemic. And this is the main behavior that people are interested to look at, the cumulative number of infected, that curve is become flat, so that means horizontal, so there is no growth in the cumulative number of infected from a particular disease. Okay, then what are the other insight we can have from this kind of simple model? So let us have a look at different experimental result. So we can increase the number of infected on the initial day, or we can decrease the number of infected on the initial day. We can consider some different values of beta, how it affects the system dynamics, or even it may happen that suppose in a boarding school there was a holiday, so after some time few individual student they joined at a later stage on the boarding, and depending upon the fact whether they are susceptible or infected, you can simply perform some preliminary numerical experiment in order to understand that how such kind of phenomena can alter the disease propagation scenario. So this blue curve is for the case that I have discussed earlier, that is S0 equal to 738 and I0 equal to 25. If we change the value a little bit, so there is a decrease in number of susceptible by 5 unit and number of infected is increased by same number in order to keep the sum as 763. So then for this new initial condition marked in red, you can see this particular curve. So in general, there is not much difference into the dynamic behavior of the system, but what you can understand that at initial time point, if there would be more number of infected individual, so what will happen, that total number of infected will be little bit higher compared to the earlier case, and also the peak will appear little bit earlier compared to the case when number of infected initially was 25. Now if we consider another case, that if we decrease the number of infected individual, what will happen, that peak will appear at a later time, and also the height of the peak will be little bit lower compared to the initial case where we have considered I0 equal to 25. So next what we can do, we can do some sort of another experiment. Experiment means in this case all the susceptible individuals remain same. So for these three simulation, total number of individuals is not same, rather they differ from one another from 5 to 10 number of individuals. So for each of these simulation result, is 0 is same, but three different values of I have considered here in order to show you some kind of variation that you can observe at this number of maximum infected individual and the time point at which the maximum will appear. But the interesting point is that significant variation in the number of maximum infected, time when the number of infected will be maximum, and also the rate of growth of the number of infected, that is severely affected by the value of beta. And just try to understand from this value that I am changing the value at the fourth decimal place only. So although the number of individual is less than 800, but still if we make a small alteration at the fourth decimal place at the rate of infectivity, then you can see that number of maximum infected individual that varies from 2020 to 3050. And all these aspects are actually required in order to come up with a reliable and also efficient model of COVID epidemic, because that is much, much complex compared to the influenza in a boarding school. Okay, next I can show you one more interesting thing, that this is the just simulation result of the first simulation. Now what I'm going to consider, that suppose on the fifth day some new individuals are joining the boarding school. So first option is that 5 infected individual, they arrived on second day with respect to this simulation, but for the record of the school, it should be the 5th day. So what happens that on second day, I have added 5 infected individual here, and it shows that is a new trend in the number of infected individual in the forthcoming days. Instead of infected individual, what we can do, we can consider that, okay, some 10 susceptible individual, they have joined on the same day. So in this case, you cannot see any sudden jump at this particular position, but ultimately this will grow little bit higher compared to the earlier case. And ultimately on 11th day, they are more or less close to each other. But if you are clever enough, you can have a look at the cumulative number of infected, and that graph is not shown here very clearly, but you can check that in this case, if 10 susceptible individual join the boarding school, that will have most adverse effect compared to joining of 5 infected individuals. And that next we consider the variability in the rate of infection. So that means at some time point, beta is getting changed. So whatever simulation I have talked about, in that case, what we have assumed that over entire period of time, that beta remains constant. So beta remains constant, and then you have this kind of simulation result. But now what we can assume that in between time period, there is a decline in the force of infection, and then it comes down to a lower level. So that means your force of infection is something like this one. So it suddenly dropped from this situation to this situation. For the time being, I am not talking about anything about what is the reason, but you can just try to understand this is somehow a control measure. So if the rate of infection dropped from some higher value to lower value, then you can see this kind of change in the rate of disease propagation. So, and this indicates there is some sort of intervention in the system dynamics. Alternatively, what you can check, you can check a different aspect, that instead of suddenly jumping the force of infection from this higher level to this higher level within a fraction of time scale, rather what you can assume that it suddenly started decaying, and after certain time period, it arrived at a lower level. So if the force of infection changes in this particular way, then you can see the disease propagation will look like this one, and this is more or less same as the earlier one. But again, if you calculate the cumulative number of infected individual, you can see several important features for different rate of infections. But before going to the next part, I must mention this intervention strategy is something like you can think about. This is the very simplest way to understand that why lockdown measure or some strict restriction about the movement of the individual or some other control measures is required in order to reduce the rate of spread of the infection. That is somehow apart from medical treatment, there is a need at societal level in order to reduce the spreading speed of the epidemic. Now, next, I can talk about little bit about the ACIR model. ACIR model means here what can happen that some of the susceptible individuals are coming close contact or interacting with the infected individual, but immediately after the infection, they may not develop any disease-related symptom. Rather, during the process of disease development within the human body, they might need some sort of latent period. And after the infection, apart from infected compartment, that means one susceptible individual coming in contact with an infected individual, immediately they are not becoming infected. Rather, it takes some time, and that time period, what they spend, that might be labeled as exposed compartment. So that's why E is inserted in between S and IR in order to talk about ACIR model. But as my final goal is to give you some idea about the modeling of COVID, so instead of considering a simple ACIR model, here I just talk about SLIAR model. So here, this exposed class is now replaced by another nomenclature, that is latently infected compartment, or the individual within which the virus or bacteria is, remains at a latent phase before further proliferation. And what does it mean? That this SLIAR actually means that after latent period, some of them will develop the symptom and some of them might not develop the symptom. So as a result, that this from latently infected compartment individuals, they are dividing into two groups. One of them is infected, that means with symptom, and another one is asymptomatic. So that means they are infected, but they without any symptom. And after some time, they will get recovered and join the recovered class. So that is actually listed here. That is meaning of different symbols. Now, if we look at the model, so this is the governing equation for SLIAR model. And these are the governing equations for five different compartments. And for this model, if you calculate the basic reproduction number, comes out to be this one. But one point here I like to mention, that these quantities, that is delta and p, they are less than one. So here delta actually indicates that although they are asymptomatic, but still they can spread the infection. But the point is that this is a some sort of starting point of some flu-like diseases or some other disease also that comes under this particular level modeling approaches, that latently infected compartment, in this case, what we assume, they cannot spread the infection. So during latency period, they cannot spread the infection. So infection is spreaded only by the either infected compartment or asymptomatic infected compartment. And afterwards, they become recovered. And then finally, if we choose this kind of parameter value and these as the initial conditions, that is total number of susceptible at initial time 5,000, latently infected is only 5, and asymptomatic individual is 4. Could you please switch off your microphone? I can see one disturbing sound. Okay, thank you. Okay, so with this one, if we just have a look at the disease propagation, so you can see this is the total number of, that means the daily number of infected individual with the advancement of time. And interesting point is that whatever parameter value I have chosen for that, you can see that number of infected is much, much less compared to latently infected and asymptomatic individuals. So now if I show you the plots for other compartment, this red one is the asymptomatic. So these asymptomatics are much less compared to the infected. But now if we incorporate the latently infected, so latently infected compartment is much, much larger than this one. So this somehow indicates that although they were exposed to the infected individual, but in this case, they have strong immune response. So that's why either virus or some sort of these things, they can develop, but not in a severe manner. So as a result, from latently infected compartment, they can slowly move to either infected compartment or asymptomatic compartment, and ultimately they will get recovered. And this is the violet color curve is the progression of susceptible compartment, and green color card is the progression of the recovered compartment. And also in this case, we have assumed there is no disease related death rate. So ultimately, this recovered compartment is approaching to the value of the number of susceptible individuals from where we have started. And ultimately, it should be a little bit higher than this one, because apart from the susceptible individual at the initial time, we also take care of the fact what was the total number of asymptomatic and latently infected individual. They will also get recovered. Okay, now I talk about little bit about the SARS epidemic model, because SARS, this particular epidemic, has a long history compared to COVID. So now we have a little bit estimate that every year how many SARS cases we have observed, what are the different places within a country or different countries over the our entire world where SARS epidemic outbreak we can observe. And once SARS epidemic outbreak occurs, then we have an idea that what will be the total number of infected individuals will there and how many of them will become susceptible, because it is not spreaded everywhere. So entire healthy population should not be considered as a susceptible compartment. So what happens that once SARS kind of epidemic disease starts spreading, so there will be a rate at which individuals from healthy compartment, they become susceptible, maybe due to their nature of job, or maybe some of them, they are not careful about their precautionary measures, etc. So that's why there is a constant inflow from healthy compartment to susceptible compartment. And as a result, what we need to consider in case of SARS epidemic, that's another important observation, that once they are exposed, if somehow we are able to know that who are exposed individuals or they come close interaction with the infected individual, you can quarantine them. But this quarantine phenomena might not be 100% successful. So this exposed compartment now can be divided into two parts. One, they are progressing to the infected compartment, and another compartment, they are quarantined. Although there is a quarantine, but quarantine is not the medical treatment. So some of them, they can develop the disease. So quarantine in the sense that they cannot spread the disease anymore. But the point is that from some of the quarantine individual, the disease growth may be severe, and as a result, they may need some sort of hospitalization. And that's why J is the hospitalized compartment. So the contribution in the hospitalized compartment can come from either infected compartment or hospitalized quarantine compartment. And as a result, there will be recovery either from infected compartment without traveling through the hospital, or infected individual, they are recovering after moving through the hospitalized compartment. And these are the means some sort of nomenclature of different compartments I have used. And model looks like this one. First one is the growth rate for susceptible. Second one is the exposed, then quarantine compartment, then infected compartment, then hospitalized compartment, and finally recovered compartment. Now, in this case, what you will have? You will have two important observations. One is basic reproduction number, and another one is controlled reproduction number. What is the difference between basic reproduction number and controlled reproduction number? So once we impose some mechanism that, okay, if you are exposed, you need to go for quarantine yourself for certain time period. So that is a control measure. And also the point is that if we consider the hospitalization of the infected individuals, so that means they cannot freely roam around. And if the medical facilities is well protected from their technical side regarding their precautionary measure from the disease propagation perspective, then what will happen that those individuals who are severely ill and hospitalized, they are also not spreading the disease. So that's why the contribution towards the basic reproduction number coming from those compartments is now reduced. And that's why we need to talk about two different things, that is basic reproduction number and controlled reproduction number. And as a result, you can have this R0 is the basic reproduction number, assuming there is no control mechanism. And second one is the controlled reproduction number. And you can see that controlled reproduction number is a much more larger or complicated expression it has compared to the basic reproduction number. And this is some sort of beauty of simple algebra. Although it contains a lot of positive terms, but as of now, we are not concerned about the magnitude. But in case of most of the models with appropriate parameter estimation, what you can find that controlled reproduction number, that is this expression, give you lower value compared to the basic reproduction number without any control. And that's why from here, in order to control the epidemic disease, we can actually just play with this controlled reproduction number, that how quickly and how efficiently or what will be the different successful mechanisms is going to be imposed in order to control the spread of the epidemic within a small period of time. So that's why this controlled reproduction number plays a very crucial role in case of large epidemic or even pandemic, where human intervention is required in order to slow down or in order to stop the spread of the disease. Okay, now I come to the case of epidemic model with demography. Epidemic model with demography means if we are talking about some disease which persists for say a couple of decades, or we have the idea about the pattern of epidemic growth of at least 10 years, so then you can incorporate some of the demographic term into your modeling approach. So what are those demographic terms? So here I have mentioned something. So that means we can divide the epidemic model into two groups, explicit demography and without explicit demography. So keep in mind, in case of COVID epidemic, it should be any model without demographic term. Unfortunately, if I look at the number of paper published so far on COVID, at least 80 to 90% paper, they have considered model with demographic term. If you are interested to know the answer towards the end, if time permits, I'll give you the answer that why this consideration of demographic term does not make any sense in case of COVID. But quickly, I can make a comment here. As per classical references and as per appropriate idea or clinical insight about the epidemic disease, it is well accepted that in order to have an estimate of the demographic parameter, we need data for at least 10 years. So whosoever they have constructed a model, wherever it is published, I can challenge them. Wherever it is published, either it is in Nature or in Science or Lancet, just throw them out if the COVID epidemic model contains some demographic term. Because we are not very much clear about the nature of epidemic spread, and then question of considering demographic parameter or their estimate is just a matter of joke. There is nothing epidemiology or mathematical epidemiology involved there. Okay, apart from that, there are some other aspects that I have listed here. I am not going through it. If you are interested, you can have a look. But what I can explain that in case of model with demographic term, you can have some additional terms here. So this capital lambda, this denotes the rate of recruitment of the susceptible individuals from the healthy compartment, and mu is the natural mortality rate of the population. So this particular mu is actually same for S and I and R. Keep in mind, here you have one additional term, that is alpha. This is not disease related death rate. Rather, this is the measure of recovery rate, because you can see that minus alpha I is departing from infected compartment and arriving at the recovered compartment. So this is the recovery rate. But as we consider this as over a longer time period, so this natural death rate is required to be considered in order to couple with this particular model setup. And again, in this case, what you can find immediately, you can find that total number of susceptible, infected and recovered are not constant, rather they follow this kind of differential equation. And one can ask the question that why all these parameters are considered as same, just for mathematical simplicity. In reality, if you are interested, you can consider all of these constants as different, and that will be much more realistic epidemic model rather than this one. But ultimately, what we can say that, okay, how much means what will be the some sort of limiting value of n, that you can mathematically calculate from here. But the point is that if you look at this limit, then you can understand that none of the parameter involved with the appropriate disease have no role to play with. Rather, the total rate of recruitment and death rate, these are the responsible factor in order to determine the final size of the epidemic. And that is well accepted because in this case, there is no disease-related death rate. You can verify that if there is a disease-related death rate, then final or limiting size of the N will be controlled by that parameter also. And what we can do for any analytical study, we can just work on with this particular model, because you can see that this R compartment has no contribution either in the S compartment and I compartment. So rather, you can work with only S and I compartment, and you can just drop the R compartment for further mathematical analysis. And here what you can do, you can make some non-dimensionalization in order to reduce the number of parameter. How this can be done? It can be done with this kind of transformation of the variables, and this S cap and I cap, they are related with the time scale, and this time scale change is given by this one. And the two parameters which are involved with the simplified SIR dimensionless model, that is rho and R0, where R0 is nothing but basic reproduction number. And from here, you can find some insight. And here, this is a model where you can see that SIR model with disease-related mortality. So that's why apart from mu and alpha, we have an additional term that is gamma, which denotes the disease-related death rate. Okay, now I am not going into the details of this, because if I need to talk about it, then I need at least 1.5 hours in order to describe all these things. But just I want to give you some idea that what other things can be done or people have done within this simple model setup, that there is a possibility that SIR model with saturating incidence. I am not going to discuss what is the epidemic background where we can see such kind of saturation of incidence, but if you are interested, you can look at some book that I'll mention towards the end of my talk. And this is another interesting force of infection that is called nonlinear force of infection. And what happens that there is a human behavior related mechanism which is responsible for nonlinear force of infection. The simple idea is that if there is too much of infection and those information about the infection is already known by healthy and susceptible individuals, and they can avoid visiting the places where we can see most infected individuals are located, and as a result, that human behavioral avoidance of the area which are most important with the spread of the disease, that can be avoided by the susceptible compartment. And as a result, what you can see, there is a decline in the force of infection, and that's why this nonlinear function is required to be incorporated. Now, with this much last couple of minutes, let me talk about mathematical modeling of COVID-19. I must make it clear that we have done couple of work in this area, but what is most interesting to me, that I am going to talk about here. So for this mathematical modeling of COVID, this is a joint work with my two friends, Chornali and Vitali. And Vitali is, I must say, the person, you can say either a well-wisher, but according to me, he's a some sort of culprit who dragged me in this area of epidemic business. Before 2020, I was not that much interested with epidemiology. So you can just now and onwards gladly accept that I'm not delivering this talk as an expert, rather as a keen learner. So whatever I have talked so far, that I have learned in during this COVID spread, or rather we can say lockdown period at IIT Kanpur. We are bound to stay at our home. Students are not in the department. Classes are online. So rest of the time I spent to learn the epidemiology. Okay. So in this case, what we have done, we have actually considered different compartments looking at the details of the epidemic spread. There is one susceptible compartment, that is fine. Now, exposed compartment, they are divided into two groups. So exposed but non-infectious and exposed with infectious. There are several articles available in different journals who have given the appropriate, I must say, that morphology of the disease spread. That means how virus get attached with the human body through the respiratory tract and then start proliferating within that and then coming out to infect others. So depending upon all these clinical details and epidemic details, we have divided or we have considered different compartments. Now, after this exposed compartment, there is the infected compartment. As usual, they are divided into two parts, that is infected asymptomatic and infected symptomatic. And then there are two more compartments, quarantine compartment, hospitalized compartment, and recovered compartment. So this work we have completed by the June last year. So frankly speaking, if we want to have an effective model for different countries or which may be valid for different countries, then we need to consider few more compartments here. That quarantine may be from susceptible compartment, maybe from exposed compartment, or as we have done here, only from the infected compartment. But just for simplicity, we can consider this kind of flowchart for disease propagation. So from susceptible, they are approaching towards the exposed and then proceeding towards the infective, exposed and infectious. They actually moving to two compartment, that is symptomatic and asymptomatic. And here it is assumed that not a single individual from asymptomatic individual, they need any hospitalization or severe or serious quarantine measure. And these kind of formalities or this kind of mechanism is valid for some foreign countries, not from India. So that's why we have actually compared this model with some with data from some European country with appropriate estimates of different parameters. And then from quarantine compartment and symptomatic compartment, there is a hospitalized compartment. And of course, there is a disease-related death rate either from the symptomatic individual and from hospitalized compartment. But as it is an early stage of the model, at by that time, there was no report from European countries that asymptomatic individuals, they might face some sort of severe means breakdown in any part of their organ, which may leads to life-threatening situation. So that's why I must admit that this is a some sort of initial type of model. Do not trust as a final model for the epidemic disease progression in all the countries. Okay, so this is the explicit form of the model formulation. I am not going into the details, just to show that what how the model looks like. I have written the model here, and then I can mention a couple of things. So for our model, this is the basic reproduction number. But once you look at the control reproduction number is, as usual, is a big expression compared to the ordinary reproduction number, and where this delta 1, delta 2, delta 3, these are given by these constants. But apart from that, what we have calculated for this large model, that final size of the epidemic, and you can see that final size, it looks like that, okay, it simply depends upon initial size of the susceptible, final size of the susceptible, and the total number of individuals in a particular area or state or country or province, and the basic reproduction number. But keep in mind that this control reproduction number actually consists of several parameters which are involved with the different mechanisms which are responsible for progression of individuals from one compartment to other compartment. So although these equations looks like very simple in terms of SF, but actually its determination and its analysis depends upon each and every parameter involved with the model. And as we need to understand that which parameter might not affect significantly on the determination of final size of the susceptible individual, which in turn give you the measure for the final size of the epidemic, we need to perform some sort of sensitivity analysis. I am not going to talk about sensitivity analysis here, but just for your information that why we need sensitivity analysis. But afterwards, if you consider the solution of this problem, then the solution of problem comes out to be very simple one, that is LNX plus RC 1, 1 minus x equal to 0, that means x lies between 0 and 1 will give you the solution. So we have worked out this problem in order to ensure that, okay, if we assume the COVID epidemic is a single peak epidemic, then what would be the possible size of the final susceptible individual? So that is what will be the total number of infection that we can measure just by solving this simple equation and then substituting all the parameters, values which we have estimated. But the interesting point is that this model also gives a measure between finally recovered individual and number of death. This ratio should follow this constant omega, and where this omega depends upon all these parameter values. And keep in mind that here, in case of RC1, beta is involved, and frankly speaking, in case of COVID epidemic, beta is not constant, rather it actually varies with time. We cannot consider its variation on each and every day or after every week. Rather, for Germany, we are able to find out some nice information and data for that country, such that we were able to successfully estimate what will be the values of beta, that means rate of infection before the imposition of lockdown, during the lockdown, and after the successful implementation of lockdown phenomenon. These are the interpretation of different parameters, their default values and units. These are presented in this table. I'm not going to read out this table. And then what we have done, we have considered two different situations. In one case, we have assumed that initially there was higher value of disease progression. So that means rate of infection spread was quite high. Due to lockdown measurement for these many days, infection level comes down to an intermediate level, and then it becomes at this level. Alternatively, what we can consider, because these are completely mathematical assumption, if you ask me the question, what is the ecological background, or what is, sorry, epidemiological background, or some sort of explanation how you can defend your claim that okay, beta value should change from this higher value to lower value. So just give me to turn this slide once more. And another case, what we have assumed, that okay, it was at a higher value, then start decaying and comes down to this level, and then maintains this particular level when the, we can say, disease spread is under control. But the point is that once we are considering that there is a decline from this level to this level, who ensures, or how we can claim that there is only one path? Answer is that this is not our claim. This is just a simple illustration. With this approach, if we can estimate all the parameter values, also what we have done, we have actually estimated what will be this level, what will be this level, and also we have estimated what will be the days on from which it will start decaying and from which it will maintain again a constant value. These are also estimated while we have made an attempt to fit the model outcome with the available data of a particular country. So that's why if you are interested, if you have a close look at our paper, then you can see for some other country, we need to consider 2-3 more interval instead of just one interval over which it declines from a higher value to lower value. And this is actually explicit data available for Germany. This red one is the effective reproduction number, and this black one is they have calculated from daily reported individuals, that is daily data for beta. And from where, what we have calculated, we have calculated the least square curve which fits with this particular data, such that it follows this one, and this one. And from where we actually calculated this higher value of beta, then slope of the decline of beta value, and then the lower value of beta, in order to have a good match with the cumulative number of infected. And with this parameter set, you can see parameter values are given in three columns. So this is before lockdown. This is the time period over which beta value declines. And then this is the after, means a third phase when the beta value settles down to a lower value. So some of the parameter values are changed significantly, but some of them remains more or less unaltered up to second or third decimal place appropriately have chosen. So here you can see the left panel corresponding to the choice of beta value, that is a step function, and the right one, it gives you certain decline from higher value to lower value connected through a straight line segment. And in this case, what you can see that cumulative number of infected towards the middle of May 2020, that is much well matched compared to the earlier one. And also, if you look at the match with the Delhi infected data, then red dots are actually Delhi infected. This blue color card corresponds to the fact that there is a sudden jump from higher level to middle level and then to lower level. But this magenta color card corresponds to the fact that beta value, that is first one remains at a higher level, then it slowly declines, and then it remains at a lower level in order to have these three graphs. And now if you look at the 95% confidence interval for the data from Germany, left panel for the cumulative infected individuals, and right one is for Delhi infected individuals, you can see there is a good agreement between the observed value and that means data available and numerical simulation. But I must say that reporting of data or collection of data is not good enough for several countries at several time points. That might be one possible explanation that at certain time interval there is some sort of disagreement of our result and the reported data. But of course, I am not defending my result. Rather, I want to make one more important point here. You can see that there is a significant mismatch at initial level with Delhi infected cases. This might happen that the time point from when they have started reporting, we might need some appropriate data from some earlier date, but unfortunately those are not available. So it may happen, as we need to start with the 15th of February 2020, we might have erroneously calculated initial exponential growth rate, and that's why there might be some mismatch at initial level of time. Okay, this is the matching with the data from Italy, this is the match with the data from Spain, and this is the match with data from UK during the first wave of COVID-19. Now our next challenging question was, by the end of June we thought about this idea that what may happen or what is going to happen once the lockdown restrictions are withdrawn. So in that paper, we have explained and we have proposed one idea that is might not be well accepted by many of the people, maybe for the reason because calculation is quite complicated. But what we have reported there, we have considered that after relaxation of lockdown restrictions, what may happen, one group of people might not follow all the restrictions. They can remove their mask. They might not follow the hygiene, like washing hand, etc. So precautionary measures are not taken. They might gather in a large group, and depending upon that fact, what we have done, we have considered that, okay, suppose from this day and onwards there is some sort of relaxation of the lockdown measurement. So what will happen, that entire population is now divided into two groups. One group is following the norm, another group is not following the norm. And depending upon that fact, what we have speculated that if in case of a population for which the entire population size is say 10 million, like pretty close to the total population of Germany or France. So what can happen, that suppose from this day and onwards there is a relaxation of the lockdown mechanism, and by that time basic reproduction number, although less than one, but less than one is not a good mathematical statement because it might be 0.99 or it may be 0.1 or it may be 10^-5. But what we have given or we have mentioned in that paper, that suppose we have R0 value at different level, say 0.9, 0.8 or 0.7, and then we consider Suppose 10% of the population is not following the precautionary norm, or 20% population is not following the precautionary norm. So is there any possibility of having second wave after the first wave? Answer is yes. Here we have shown that if 10% of the population does not follow the precautionary norm, so there is a slow increase in the number of infected individuals. But if this ratio changes from 1 to 9 to 2 to 8, so you can clearly observe that rate of growth of the second peak of the epidemic is much more faster compared to the first peak. And when we have submitted this paper, then reviewer asked the question, can you validate or can you justify your answer from any data? And we were lucky enough that the time when we were asked to revise our paper, or that there was a condition that if you cannot support your claim, then this paper will not be accepted. Unfortunate for the human being, but fortunate for us, by that time we have data for Spain, and for that data from Spain we have estimated those K value, and we have shown that this curve is fitted well with the data from Spain. And afterwards, with same terminology and same mathematical formulation, we have matched our model with the data from Israel. And here you can see, not only the second peak matches well with this particular model setup, rather initial growth and decline that can also be captured in appropriate manner. But sometimes there is a disagreement. Keep in mind, this disagreement appears only for the reason all the time we made some sort of effort in order to maintain the cumulative number of infected should match with the data and the simulation result. So that's why there might be some sort of disagreement. But of course, there is another possible explanation, that reporting is not that much deterministic as the model simulation follows. Okay, before coming to the end, I must talk about this work that was published in Applied Mathematics Letter. This was a very interesting observation. What we have done, okay, we can consider the population into two groups. Very simple model, just in order to have all the results explicitly. We have considered people divided into two groups. Here, not for the same nomenclature, that is, one group is following the norm, other group is not following the norm. Rather, what we can consider, one group is super spreader and another group, due to some reason, they don't need to interact with common people. So there is a less chance of getting infection or spreading the infection. So what we have done, we have actually divided the population into two groups. One group, they can easily catch the infection or easily spread the infection, and other group may not catch the infection that much easily, or may not spread infection easily. Because, for example, you can think about the frontline worker, they are more vulnerable to catch the disease by their profession, not due to their behavior. And what is the meaning of this V1 and V2 and etc.? So this is some sort of tricky mathematical assumption, that after certain time period of we will have some available number of vaccine. So the understanding is that on a first day or on a single day, we can have the entire requisite number of vaccine is available. So what we have considered, this model actually serves the two purpose. Number one, vaccine is not available at a time, rather vaccine is required to be administered step by step. That is one interpretation of this model. Another interpretation of this model is that once certain individuals are vaccinated, they are not leaving the susceptible compartment or the infected compartment, rather they need some time in order to grow the antibody within their body. So starting from the day of vaccination, we need to wait for certain time period after which they will leave the susceptible compartment. And that's why here I have mentioned as T0, but T0 is not a fixed one, rather this T0 takes different time point, so T1, T2, T3 and so on. So with this, I'm not going into the mathematical detail, just to show you some result. This is a very nice interpretation. Interpretation is that what will be the total number of vaccination required, or percentage of vaccination is required, with the understanding that 10% of the individual, they are say super spreader, 20% of the individuals, they are super spreader, or 30% individual, they are super spreader. So this dark color, that include that if your number of vaccine lies within this range, so there is a chance of further growth of the epidemic. But if your number of vaccination is greater than this level, so then there is no chance of some sort of further growth of the epidemic. But what is the interesting observation? That mathematical model clearly shows that if more and more people follow all COVID-related norms and they are very much cautious, then less number of vaccine can control the epidemic spread within a very restricted time period. And that we have shown in this diagram. So this is the idea that we can have two different situations. One situation is that once vaccine is arriving, you are administering the vaccine in a random manner. So that means irrespective of the distribution of the group of people into two or three or more group, each and every time, suppose you are getting 1 lakh vaccines, and that is arbitrarily administered to the individual. So that follows this particular path. But here we have shown three different paths. So for example, in one case, super spreaders are more rapidly vaccinated compared to the people who have less chance of the spread of the disease. Then what can happen? That random vaccination, that can lead to much higher number of infected individual if again outbreak occurs. And this scaling is available on the right panel. But for other three graphs, that is red, green, and magenta, the scale is given on the left-hand line. And you can see here the maximum value of 2,500. Here the maximum value is 500. And it clearly shows that instead of random vaccination, rather this is a mathematical illustration of the result, that you have to design an optimal vaccination strategy in order to control the epidemic spread within a small time interval, and also in order to ensure if there is an outbreak, then total number of infected individual will be much, much less. Otherwise, what we can clearly observe, that in case of random vaccination, the total number of infected will be at least 4 to 5 times higher compared to the case where we have a planned vaccination strategy. Okay, last 2-3 minutes, I can talk about what is the main challenge for modeling COVID spread in India. This is the data for Maharashtra during the first wave. What you can see, you can just consider this epidemic disease spread in the nearby states. That means the states which share the common boundary with Maharashtra, then you can find there is 6 states. So first of all, you can just try to understand that whether the disease propagation in all 6 neighboring states are same or not. If you look at the plot, these are the data from 6 different states like Gujarat, Chhattisgarh, Karnataka, Goa, Telangana, and Madhya Pradesh. So then you can see the rate of progression, number of peak, their rate of decline, or time when they arrive, when we arrive at the peak, they are drastically changing from one state to other state, whether they are nearby state of Maharashtra. So that's why we need to understand the way of the epidemic disease spread in nearby states is not similar as in case of Maharashtra. So that's why my, or rather our understanding is that if you are interested to construct an efficient model for a large country like India, where we can see different rate of disease spread at different states, so efficient model will be at least you construct a model for different regions. I am not arguing the fact that you need to construct the model for each state, rather different regions where you can see similar pattern of disease growth. Otherwise, whatever prediction you are going to make, that will not make any sense from appropriate epidemiological point of view. So what we have done, we have actually considered some coupled map lattice kind of modeling approach just to show that after the first wave, if there is some sort of withdrawn of the lockdown mechanism and other restrictions are now withdrawn, then what can happen? There will be travel of the individual from nearby states, and as we don't have appropriate data that how many people are traveling by bus or how many by train or how many by air. So, but what we have shown, mathematically we have shown that if we consider this kind of multi-compartment model and match with the data for different states, there is a good agreement between the model simulation and the data we have. But what we have observed that if we allow the movement of the individuals from one state to another state and each of them are not able to follow all the restriction, whatever may be the reason, I am not going to mention about the reason behind it, but it clearly indicates that if the movement of the individuals from one state to other state crosses some threshold, so there is a chance of further epidemic growth. And this is a one type of model. I'm not showing you all the models that we have considered, but what you can see that this graph actually indicates that if 10% of the people allowed to move from one state to other state, there will be the growth that will follow this red curve. If more than 10%, say 15% is allowed to grow, move from one state to other state, so it shows there is a chance of possible growth of the epidemic in near future. And this was just some sort of illustrative purpose we have used this simulation result, but actually you can understand after 3rd January 2001 what was the actual situation in Maharashtra. But keep in mind, I am not claiming the fact that this is the only reason for which there was a huge number of cases in Maharashtra. Rather, this is a some sort of mathematical exercise or mathematical tools or mechanism by which we can capture such kind of disease growth, and those estimates can be obtained easily if we have appropriate data and information for this. But another important point that I like to mention, in case of India, you should be careful about the model formulation and prediction, because the number of testing at different places across our country is not at desired level compared to the other countries are concerned. So this is the number of infected and number of testing. Those are actually plotted with same vertical length of the scale, but actual scaling is little bit different. So here what you can see, that Delhi infected is the blue curve, Delhi tested is the red curve. So what happens, you can clearly observe that once there is a increase in the number of Delhi infected, there is a sharp decline in the number of tests. According to my understanding, this is quite dangerous. I am not making any comment what can happen afterwards, but this is a clear-cut observation from the data available from reliable data source like COVID-19 India or India.org or our Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Both the website shows the similar kind of data trend. And now if you look at the similar kind of plot for India, this is during second wave, you can see when the peak started taking its highest point, you can easily understand what is the rate of change of the slope of the increase of this disease growth. And instead of increasing sufficient number of tests, there is a significant decline in the rate of growth of the testing per day. And once peak started declining, then for a couple of days there was some higher number of testing, and before the basic reproduction number coming down to one, there is a significant decline in the number of tests. I hope whatever I wanted to convey the message, you already got the message. I must stop at here. And these are some information that apart from that, there are other modeling approaches. I must mention that whatever model I am talked about, that is not the only mathematical tools by which you can model COVID epidemic spread. These are all different kind of models, and some other models I have missed, I must admit. And finally, these are our some other work that is following the approach that I have mentioned in the last but one slide. And these are some references. So these are the sources from where we have collected the data, or we have used the data from these sources. And as I told you earlier, that some behavioral mechanism is very much important. If you are interested, you can have a look at this book. That is a very nice book titled that Modeling the Interplay Between Human Behavior and Spread of the Infectious Disease. And for basic mathematical understanding, either you can have a look at the book by Maya Marcheva or this book, or there are several other books by Odo Dieckmann and others, maybe Rohani and Killing, so many books are available. You can have a look at it. And these are two interesting, rather my favorite article in case of COVID. One is ground reality versus model-based computation of basic reproductive numbers in epidemic. If you are interested, you can have a look at it. I hope this is already published. I did not get a chance to cross-verify whether it is published or not. And this is another interesting news article, that traditional model for disease spread may not work in COVID-19. But who cares about this appropriate scientific news article? Rather, most of the people, they have adopted some erroneous modeling approach, and that's why all various kinds of prediction is coming up. Before saying you thank you or goodbye, I must mention that any predictive model in case of COVID, if they talked about more than 15 days prediction, the simple question humbly I must ask them, can you tell me what is the basis based upon which you can make a prediction for COVID for more than 10 to 15 days? If you look at any scientifically and clinically correct modeling approach in all the appropriate manuscript or paper, they have mentioned that in case of COVID, prediction beyond 15 days is impossible, because now you have a data for more than 1.5 years for any particular country. You can just test. Suppose you have made a prediction on June 2020 for the prediction in July or August or end of the November, then you can verify there is a significant mismatch between the model prediction and the reality. Why? This is only for the reason there is several change in the vaccination policy, several unforeseen declaration about the relaxation of the lockdown mechanism or the strict protection mechanism, vaccination strategy, etc., etc. Those are responsible for non-uniform disease progression in case of COVID-19. And this is the person, Vitaly Volpart, who dragged me in this kind of COVID-related matter. And when I told him that, okay, COVID is now is a horrible term, and then he said, okay, you can think about an alternative abbreviation, that collaboration, observation, visualization of infectious diseases. I have borrowed this idea from him. And these are my, this is my student Shomiran, and this is my friend Shornali, and Sebastian Onita. Whatever work I have presented for us from on this COVID, that I mainly did with these four people. And some other work for which I did not talk about, but just mentioned at the reference, those are done with these people like Onuj Mubai, Sergei Petrovsky, and Alberto Donofrio, and many others. And thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Mullah, for this very, very nice and superbly delivered talk. And I should ask participants, if you have any question in this regard, then I think Mullah will be very pleased to answer those questions. So I think there should be questions from the participants. And do you have any question, participants? Yes, some comments are coming out, but
yeah, that is appreciation, but I want question.
Yes. Yes, sir. If there is any question, I'm just waiting then. So if not, let us thank the speaker once again, and we will be now. Yeah, one thing. Yeah, one question I got. This is written in the chat box.
We are able to get predictions. How far we are able to resolve the issue? As I have mentioned, this is impossible to resolve the issue. For COVID-related matter, as of now, according to my opinion, any prediction beyond 15 days does not make any sense. And if any people is making any prediction about when third wave will start, what will be the peak or what will be the duration of the third wave, you can ask him or her, can you explain what is the mechanism? Because the mechanism which will be responsible for the next wave is not pretty much clear, because that may be due to relaxation of some lockdown norm, maybe less number of vaccination, maybe mutation of some viral strain. So many different causes are might be responsible for the next wave. So without knowing the cause, how one can predict that what will be the next time when again we can see the growth of the epidemic further? So whatever people are making, I have not seen any fundamental answer to the question, what will be the cause for the next wave? And for example, I can give you a simple clue. If you have a look at the data for Delhi, then you can clearly observe when India have observed the second wave, by that time Delhi is actually observed the fourth wave. If we consider the number of local maxima in the Delhi reported case as the indication of wave, and if you want to have the precise measure of the wave in terms of epidemiology, I must mention that second wave is starting, we can say, only for the reason we can, or at the time when we can ensure that basic reproduction number became less than one. Sometimes people are using some model for which basic reproduction number is less than one, but actually what you need to do, you need to calculate from appropriate data. And in case of India, I was not that much confident before April or May 2021 that there is a lack of reporting of the data. But now I am quite confident for the reason that I also suffered from COVID. Even belonging to IIT Kanpur, there was a confirmatory test that I have tested positive. But there was no test afterward that my COVID report is negative. So in this way, India is proceeding towards the coming days. And I don't know what different aspects are already hidden for our near future. So the point is that I must say that it is not possible to estimate that. Lot of parameters involved, how one can put all parameters and model become more complex, how reliable will be our mathematical model like cancer. Okay. Don't mix up with cancer and this thing. So cancer is a cell level mathematical model. This is a population level mathematical model. But if you want the answer that how this can be handled, either you can handle the problem with large research group, number one, or people from different area, or sometimes you can take help of a parallel computing facilities in order to estimate the parameter. But the point is that what will be the number of parameter required to be estimated, what will be the number of components is required to be considered in the model, that is depending upon the fact what is your final goal. If you have multifaceted goal for your model outcome, then you need to understand that basic question what you are interested to answer for your problem. That means whether you are interested to calculate cumulative number of infected or number of possible hospitalization or underreported cases. So
Yeah, please wait. I think there is a problem from Professor Banerjee's end. Just wait. Have patience. So in between, as he joins, we will be progressing towards, let him join first. And I have to say one thing, that we will now proceed for the corresponding, the final session. This is the valedictory session of the entire program. And I already have sent one email to all of you, which actually gives you an idea that we will provide the corresponding, what is called, can you hear me, everyone? Am I audible?
Yes, it's clear. Yes.
Yes. So the point is, just what I want to say that let Molloy first join, then
yeah,
he will complete
I'm
the
here.
Discussion. Okay. So can you just continue the matter? Actually, your voice was not coming. That's why.
Yeah, actually, I missed one question. Kaushik, could you please read
the last
question?
One is how many peaks we can face actually expected? That means how many peaks are waiting? That was the last question.
Nobody can say. Nobody can give any answer to this question, because frankly speaking, if I ask the question, do you have any idea that how many possible mutation is coming up in coming couple of months or couple of years, if anyone have idea, then we can think about it. Otherwise, we cannot say how many peaks we can see or how many waves we can see for in case of COVID. And with the idea of flu, what we can say, it will remain, but what will be the intensity, that we can try to control. We means not mathematician, rather administrations and some doctors and other clinical people who can give more insight, that means towards the biology of the disease propagation, not from modeling perspective.
I think the questions are being answered. I think no other question left. I just have one simple thing just to share, that what I have noticed in the previous case, that after the end of the first wave and before to start the second wave, a prolonged number of days we are watching that in a pan-India level, the values are coming daily basis around 8,000 and 9,000 in between. And it was stagnant for so many days. Then by the mid of February, the second wave emerged. And now we are facing the same kind of thing, that almost around 35 to 45 around, I just approximately say, the total
yes.
values are very stagnant in between. So yeah. Can we expect that by this value, we will start emerge towards a third wave? That means, can we have in this kind of trend that the valley size, the height of the valley is getting enhanced as we are progressing towards the next week?
The point is that my simple question will be, can we get the answer to this question from a different perspective? What is the why not number of testing is increased? Rather, I can say that number is maintained at that level just by reducing the number of testing. And the point is that in order to have some idea that when next wave will come or something like that, then it is not possible for any people, I think, to know publicly what is the sero culture data for the people who are arriving in India from abroad. Theoretically, flights are stopped, but there are so many flights running between India and several other countries, because I know personally, three of my friends, they are accidentally today flying from different parts of the globe to Delhi and Calcutta today itself. So we don't have that much data that how many of them, whether they are bringing Delta strain or not, because the most point which is more to be give appropriate attention, that whether the vaccinated individuals without developing any kind of symptom can spread the disease any more or not. That is most important question.
Right.
And, but of course, I must agree with you that this stagnation, whether it is an indication of further decline or it is an indication of further growth, nobody knows. Rather, it would be interesting to have the appropriate distribution of different strain across our country and also appropriate vaccination map in order to understand that if there is outbreak due to some older strain or Delta plus strain, then what will be the epidemic spread rate or growth rate in the near future.
Right. So thank you very much. Thank you, Maulay, for your very wonderful explanations and very wonderful talk. So let us now move towards the final one, that is the validity session. So I request Professor Arindam Bhattacharya, our Honorable Secretary, to start the proceedings.
Now, thank you, Kaushik. Today, we first show respect